Good morning, welcome back to Computational Finance, Applied Mathematical Finance. I'd like to continue with interest rates. And now that we have defined several interest rates, I will maybe move to interest rate products that will be in the next section. But already now we encounter a first, you could say, interest rate product from which we then derive yet another interest rate. And this scheme will appear again in the next session when we will define the swap from which we derive yet another interest rate, the so-called swap rate. So we started here with zero coupon bonds, then defined the forward bond as a special financial product. So how much money do you have to pay in a future point in time? And from that we derived the interest rate, the forward rate. And if you remember back that on my first slide, I had this reinvestment strategy. So now I can write my reinvestment strategy again in the interest rate L. Yeah? And I can define the accrual account or money market account. So assume we have some time discretization given. So again, as before, I have a time discretization that somehow discretizes the interest rate periods. So I can invest from T0 to T1, from T1 to T2, and so on. Well, if I invest one unit at time T0, so what do I receive back in time T1? So I receive back 1 plus L for the period from T0 to T1. And now I receive the interest rate that I have contracted, so observed in T0. So, but for the next period, if I perform now a reinvestment, so now I perform a reinvestment. So that money goes back again here. And what I get back now is that amount of money. And the amount that I receive back then is my original amount, which is still the blue stuff, but now multiplied with 1 plus the interest rate for the period from T1 to T2, but that one was contracted at the beginning of the period, so observed in T1. So you see that you have here always the beginning of the period as the observation date of the interest rate. So in the end, you will receive this product of accumulated accrued interest. And in this financial product, every interest rate starts or fixes at the beginning of the period. This object is a random variable, okay? But with respect to the measurability, this object is FTI minus one measurable. And it's not FT0 measurable, yeah, in general. Yeah, because it is known at the end, yeah, because you see that you have here a dependency always on the time tj, and j runs to up to time I minus one. You can also use this definition with the other interest rates, okay? For example, the instantaneous forward rate. Then we have that we get not the product of one plus rate multiplied with time. It is the product of exponential rate multiplied with time. But now if you use infinitesimal periods, it is the exponential of the integral from tj to tj plus one. If observed in tj, though that guy here corresponds to my observation time. Okay, there I'm using not the notation with the semicolon, yeah, that's the second argument. So this is the observation time. Okay, so this is the case when I use these infinitesimal periods. Yeah, so then I have to integrate the infinitesimal periods to get the whole period from tj to tj plus one. And then I'm reinvesting that amount of money. Well, you see that a product of exponentials is actually the same as an exponential of the sum of the guys that are inside the exponential. So you see, this is just what we have here. Yeah, so the top line is still the same as that one, is the exponential of the sum of those integrals. Well, if you make the, this is just because this sum here is because we have this discretization. If we wouldn't have the discretization, you would have here just the integral over R. Yeah, so this goes to, yeah, for fine discretization, it goes to exponential integral. Okay, so where do we start? We start in T0 and we end in TI, right? Yeah, we end in TI. It is then R tau d tau. Yeah, but only if we go in the limit with the discretization to very fine intervals. Well, okay, so I can define from the interest rate L this financial product, the reinvestment of one unit of currency. If you go to a continuum of infinitesimal periods, this will converge, yeah, then to the well-known accrual account, the object that you also use in the Black-Scholes model, yeah, with the addition that in the Black-Scholes model, interest rates were not stochastic. So you see that this object here is the discretized analog to the bank account that you have in the Black-Scholes model. Difference is that here I have a discrete time discretization, which we need anyway in the computer. And big difference is that here we now allow stochastic interest rates. A disadvantage of this definition is that it defines the financial product, the value of the financial product. It defines this value only at certain times. So what is the value in between? So what is the value of this financial product here in between? So what I'm actually doing here is I always invest here in a zero coupon bond that pays at the end. So this is always a small reinvestment into zero coupon bonds that pay at the end of the next period. So I can generalize this definition to an object that really presents a financial product, namely invest into the next zero coupon bond. So this is the zero bond ending at the next period discretization point. And that here is the amount of money I have accumulated up to this point. Well, I somehow have to specify here the time. Well, the time here is just the index I that gives me the starting point of the period where my little t is currently residing. Okay, so this m of little t is the index of the starting point of the period. So then you see this here is the index of the end of the period. So if you like to have again a picture here, so here is my little t, it's somewhere in between. And here I do have the times Tm of little t, and here is Tm of little t plus 1. So now I have a financial product that has a value in every time little t. So I have a continuum here. Yeah, it's a reinvestment strategy into the next zero coupon bond. And you saw that actually this reinvestment strategy here, yeah, so we saw this product here resembles the bank account, the continuum that was used in the Black-Scholes model. So now I can ask myself, okay, what is the interest rate that I may associate with this financial product? Okay, here again on the slide, the just the remark, yeah, that this is linked to the bank account B. Well, the bank account B, well, there is a small, for example, difference. The bank account B is at time TI, usually FTI, only FTI measurable. Yeah? And this guy here is FTI minus 1 measurable, because in my time discretization, I know the value always at the beginning of a time discretization period. But for very fine periods, this difference, you see, it goes away. So, back to this question. What is, can I associate an interest rate with this? Well, if you think of this R, this reinvestment strategy, well, I invest, say, 1 unit of currency. So there's 1 euro here. I invest 1 unit of currency here. And then I have this reinvestment strategy. Maybe it evolves here a little bit, so I get a little bit more. And sometimes I get maybe less, and then I get a little bit more. And then I can ask, okay, what is the interest rate associated with this financial product? Okay, you remember that already for the bond price curve, the slope was associated with the interest rate. Well, you invest that amount of money, and then at in S, so, and then in capital T, you would like to receive back the same amount of money, but we receive back something in addition. Okay, so this something in addition is, maybe like an interest rate. So what is this? So we compare the value, our initial investment, with the amount we have at the end. Okay, so this is the percentage amount which we have at the end, yeah, so maybe 110%. And then if we subtract 1, yeah, so we receive 10% in addition. But now I would like to have an interest rate. So here I have a period. So maybe I draw this in that color here. So here I have a period. So I would like to divide again with the time period per time. This is another interest rate I could define. It is the performance of this accrual account. And it is now associated with this time discretization here. It depends a little bit on the time discretization I use here. So you see that maybe here we have this by doing small reinvestments. And it's not completely clear how does this interest rate here depend on the time discretizations. Yeah, it will depend on this if everything is stochastic, because you see that here I'm looking at different times of the stochastic processes. Yeah? So what is this rate? So it is not FS measurable. Yeah, so I do not know the rate at the beginning of the period, because the rate will
be constituted by the reinvestments which are stochastic, and I know the rate only at the end of the period. This interest rate is then sometimes called a backward rate because it is a backward looking rate. I do not contract it at the beginning of the period. I look at the rate at the end of the period. So this is a backward looking rate. The rate of the performance index, sorry, I from S to T, the performance of my reinvestment strategy, this is a backward looking rate in the sense that it's determined at the end of the period. So in contrast to this, my forward rate, my L, was FS measurable, yeah, it was known at the beginning of the period. Here, both rates apply to the same period, S of T, but they differ a little bit. A special example for such backward-looking rates are overnight index indices. So when your time discretization is so fine that it is just one day, yeah. So every day you accrue an amount, and then after 3 months you ask yourself, okay, how much money have I accrued? Okay, so this is a definition, or a financial product that is actually traded on the market, an overnight swap exchange every 3 months, the interest accrued in the past when you accrued every day. There is a relation between the backward looking rate and the forward looking rate. And this is an interesting thing, which we will need to prove. Here is the lemma. If you ask yourself, given the universal pricing theorem, so if I can perform valuation using an equivalent martingale measure, what is the value receiving the backward looking rate at the end of a period or receiving the forward rate at the end of the period? And the nice thing is that the value of the two is the same. So you see that the two objects are different from some stochastic properties. One object is known at the beginning, the other object is known at the end. But if you consider the value, the expectation, expectation relative to the numerator, then this is the same. We will prove this in the next session, and it is quite important because it means that we can treat financial products on the backward rate in the same way as financial products on the forward rate, as long as the interest rate enters linear into the financial product. Because if something is linear, expectation is a linear operator, it doesn't make a difference in expectation. That was it for this small session. Thank you.